In this lecture, we will be mainly focused on scapula. Scapula belong to shoulder girdle. This is the second bone in shoulder girdle. The first bone is clavicle that we already discussed, and the video of clavicle available on made up to date channel. So scapula means shoulder blade. This is comes from Latin origin, okay? They are translated to shoulder blade, okay? And by classification, by morphological classification of bone, this is one of the flat bone, and it is a thin bone and triangular in shape, okay? It is located posterolaterally on the upper side of thoracic. And why they name so posterolaterally? Because half of the surface of this bone, you can see here in this diagram, half of the surface located straight on the posteriorly, and half of the surface of this bone on the lateral aspect. Okay, so that's why they name this combined the posterolateral aspect. Okay, so now the medial border of this scapula lie from T2 vertebra to T7 rib, okay, and the inferior angle corresponding to the spine of the T7 vertebra, okay. So here you can see this is first rib. This is second rib, you can see here, and the border start from here and run downward. Here we have the base of scapular spine, okay, and this base of scapular spine corresponding to the spine of third vertebra, okay, so it is corresponding to the spine of third vertebra. Okay, don't be confused between vertebral body and spine. Okay, and thoracic vertebra, all the spine, they are directed downward. So this is the body, suppose, and the spine, this is the lower body, and the spine is overlapping over here. So you may think that this is the fourth vertebra, but this is not the fourth vertebra. This is the spine of the third vertebra that corresponds to base of the scapular spine. Okay, now here we have scapular spine, then further here we have angle, acromial angle. Here in this point we have acromial angle, and further this part continue is the acromial process. We will discuss in more detail about the structure, and then from here, okay, so inferior angle or lie at the seventh rib, and it corresponding to the spine of seventh vertebra. Now let's move to the other gross anatomical feature of scapula. Okay, so we have a body, like every single bone has a body and other features. Okay, scapula, similarly scapula has also has this structure and features. Okay, so scapula has two surfaces. One interiorly, the surface that attached to the rib cage, okay, to the thoracic cage, okay, and this is called ventral surface or interior surface, or this is called and we have a posterior surface. And to recognize that the posterior surface has a prominent spine here, okay, when you see the spine, so this will be posterior surface. Otherwise the anterior surface is smooth beside some ridges, 4 to 5 ridges, which is formed by the subscapularis muscle, intramuscular septa or tendon, okay, because subscapularis muscle attached to the two-thirds of the subscapularis fossa. Okay, subscapularis fossa. So this is called anterior surface, also called subscapularis fossa. and ventral surface also, okay, because it facing interiorly. Then you can see the spine on the posterior surface. It divided the posterior surface into two fossa. We have two fossa. We have supraspinous fossa, and we have infraspinous fossa. Okay. So now again you can see here. Okay, so now side determination. This is very easy. Sometimes some examiner asking the exam, let me determine its side. Okay, and most commonly this is asked question in exam because when you don't know, so it is very difficult when you didn't study about the bone, so it is very difficult to determine its side. So first of all, when you see at the bone, so find out the glenoid cavity. Because the glenoid cavity, you already know that it comes on the right, on the lateral side, okay? Because humeral head attached from the lateral side, okay, it never come medially or inferiorly or superiorly, so it must be on the right side, okay? But it facing forward, upward, and laterally, okay? So this way you can determine. So one point you already determined that the glenoid cavity, it is on the lateral side, okay? So you can see this is on the lateral side. One point you already discovered. The second point is spinous process. Spinous process must be on the posterior surface, okay, to determine whether it is anterior surface or posterior surface. Interior surface is smooth. Besides some ridges, we already mentioned about that. So it has a prominent and obvious spine. Okay, when you look at this, so it will be posterior surface. Then we have lateral border. Now, how to find the lateral border? Okay, literally you already know that literally we have the glenoid cavity and it will be here. With the glenoid cavity up to the inferior angle. Up to the inferior angle. And beside this information that it will be lateral with the glenoid cavity, look at this. This is thicker as compared to other two border. Okay. Then we have inferior angle. This is more acute. Acute means that it is more facing downward, okay, or more facing, more straight facing and directed downward. So this is more acute as compared to superior and lateral angle. So now you can determine the side very easily. So you can see here that the spine of scapular spine divided the surface into supraspinous fossa. Okay, supraspinous fossa and infraspinous fossa. Okay, it is glenoid cavity. Again, it is glenoid cavity. Okay, on the lateral side. And we have a communication gap between the supraspinous fossa and infraspinous fossa. Supraspinous fossa is small. Spinous fossa is small, and infraspinous fossa is large. Okay, and this is the spinoglenoid notch. This notch serve is a communication between the two fossa. Okay, the vessel enter the nerve and vessel passing through this to two fossa, okay, enter and exit, okay. So like suprascapular nerve, okay, it's come after originating from the brachial plexus, okay. So this suprascapular nerve, okay, it divided here and then again branches here. Okay, this is supra. Scapular nerve, okay, then branches here, and also it gave the branch infra spinous fossa also, and again branches, and it supplied to the supraspinatus and infraspinatus muscle, and similarly vessel also entered through this to supply this muscle, okay. This is supra. Spinoglenoid notch. Okay, this is spinoglenoid notch. Okay, let's move to the next section. And this may be, this is certain marking, and this is very important part in this discussion. So please be attentive. Anatomical position and serpent's marking. Okay, someone asked, did anatomical position of this bone determine, or in exam you are going to describe this. So hold the bone in a way that glenoid cuvette key, as I mentioned before, on the lateral side. Okay, and the glenoid cavity, as I said, it directed forward, slightly upward, and laterally. Okay, so hold like this. Okay, and the other thing is the inferior angle. Inferior angle lie at the seventh rib, at the level of seventh vertebral spine, as we already discussed about that in the previous section. Medial border extend from T2 to this medial border. This is T2 T2 to T7, okay, vertebral level. Root of spine lie opposite to the spine of T3 vertebra. Okay, this is root of spine, this is V-shape. Okay, or you can say this is triangular in shape. And this is corresponding to the third T3 vertebral spine. Okay, then it extend from the T2 to the T7. Okay, acromial process, it palpable. Okay, so we have two part palpable here, but we will discuss it here, and the rest of the palpable part we will discuss in the later discussion. Here, this palpable. Okay, so when you put your hand on the shoulder, the bone that you feel, that is acromion. Okay, so the only part that palpable in shoulder, this is in acromion part. This part is palpable. Okay, and subcutaneous, because there is no muscle on it. Okay, so this is interior view, and you